I am 8 years old, and sitting in the back seat of our family car, we are returning from one of those cross-Californian road trips, the kind that seemed to last forever until it didn't anymore, where we measure time by the distance in feet between each street light, the stretch of land, an open desert for miles until we reach the San Francisco Bay Area, and by that time, we've run out of things to say. We don't make it back home in time. To Mountain House, California, a small town in San Joaquin County off of Interstate 205. We don't make it back in time because we're stuck on the freeway for 4 hours in the middle of summer, thirst, and sweat. We see smoke in the distance, but it's close enough that we're all surrounded and coughing, and minutes later, I'm struggling to breathe. I'm too young to understand the weight of the word wildfire, but old enough to know that the flames were close enough to swallow us whole now. I am in the living room with my family and we are watching the news in complete silence. This is how we swallow the reality that last year was the most destructive year for wildfires in the state that I was raised in, where our family home sits abandoned and empty for us. We watched forced evacuations and frozen highways. I think of palm trees and beaches, and where I first learned to play baseball in Central Park and now open fields of ashes. I think of the irony of the word beautiful, how beautiful seems to be synonymous with temporary. But we can all pretend that this is a movie with our cast 17-year-olds burned alive during a wildfire, during a camping trip, some scars of forever. I wonder if they went back for the ashes. 8-year-old girl lost entire family during a road trip in California. She will spend the rest of her life searching, but I see myself in every victim. I keep thinking how climate change is synonym for wildfire, how it makes them more frequent, feared, and resilient. I think of fires with sparks taking months to put out. Maybe temporary is not the same as beautiful. I think how wildfire is synonym for destruction, which means costly, and how it will only be a problem when it has to do with money, which is to say that it will only be a problem when it's less expensive to solve. And now I measure time by the distance in milliseconds between the next newscast disaster and no time to breathe, to let it sink in, that each one of us is victim. I am sitting with my family in the living room watching the world burn, and I realize that maybe everyone can choose to close their eyes, but it just takes one to see climate change, synonym for wildfire, how it makes them more frequent, feared, and resilient. We were sitting still and frozen and blinking away. This is how we swallow the reality in complete silence, like a family road trip, safer. Ever since the start of time, and even before what we know of it, we have been communicating. This dates back to when our primary forms of communication didn't have to be verbal. They could have been smoke signals, or cave drawings, or when we use sign language. And now, more than ever, we've been introduced to new forms of media and technology that actually allow us to increase the ways in which we can communicate. So maybe it's a tweet, or going on Instagram and posting a photo. But overall, our main idea is that we've always been trying to deliver a message and get meaning across. And we all have this inherent need to belong, to listen, and to be heard. But as we're introduced to more forms of social media and more ways in which we can connect, we also have to understand about how different forms of communication can limit our understanding and the meaning that's presented in each one. We start asking more questions, such as how can we take dialogue and make it more powerful? Why is it important to study literature and meaning? And most of all, how can we make our interactions more meaningful, make people care what we care about, and tell our stories to inspire change in other people? So my journey with spoken word poetry started at about 2014. It's where I find that I'm able to connect stories with poetry and to be able to influence change and make people care about certain things. So I was first introduced to a few contemporary poets on Button Poetry. In 2015, I wrote my first satirical poem. And moving onwards, I actually started to perform in local poetry slams and go out and do a couple of talks and speeches. And it kind of led me through this journey where I love to talk. I love to tell stories because I felt like there was an emotion that I could connect with an audience and that I could deliver a message in something that was different than just a statistic. So today I'm going to talk to you about how storytelling can be empowering and how we can tell our stories to lead change and inspire other people. And the first thing is that it doesn't have to make sense. I think we're always pressured in a way that our stories have to make sense to other people. We've studied language and how changing language across different mediums can actually change the meaning of it. In terms of works of translation. But the message that I'm trying to get across is that every story is a language, because we almost set our own rules in the way that how we can communicate, because they're defined by our personal experiences. Let's look at the meaning of the word language. It's defined as a system of words or signs that tell people that people use to express their thoughts and feelings to each other. And this is one of the reasons that I love poetry, because it's the way in which I can express my thoughts and feelings, but I don't have to follow rules. I can make up phrases, I can even make up words, mash together words from different languages, and I can be extremely creative in any way that I want. And what I'm trying to say is that every story is a language in its way. Whenever we are communicating about our personal experiences, our pasts, and our memories, we are speaking a language that is familiar to ourselves. Next, storytelling can be honest, because after all, it's shaped by our own personal experiences. So earlier this year, I was working on something called the Knower's Profile, and for those of you who are not familiar with what that is, I actually tapped into a few of my past experiences and defined how they had changed and influenced me. And I found this to be extremely interesting and difficult, because not only could I think of events, I could think of too many, and I wasn't able to choose them. But it made me realize that we all lead incredibly different lives, and every movie that we watch, person that we meet, someone we talk to, or an influential role model, will influence us more than we think. So what we have to do is we have to try to understand ourselves. Just the idea of trying to tell our stories means that we're thinking about our past and certain events that we've gone through. Next, we can tell our stories to connect. By being vulnerable and sharing our personal experiences, it's our way of being able to connect to other people through our emotions and through the meaning that we're trying to convey. One thing that I like to say is that we lose ourselves in conversation but find each other in connotations. Whenever I have a conversation with someone, I often don't repeat every phrase or every word that they had said directly, but I think about how this conversation had made me feel, about what I had taken away from it. And that's what I realized is a lot about the same with poetry and storytelling. It's not about what exactly is being said explicitly, but more about what it makes you feel. So let's structure our stories in the same way. Instead of just telling a story that is long, that uses fancy words, let's tell stories that makes us feel something, that is meaningful and motivates us. And lastly, storytelling is a tool for social change. So I started off this presentation actually talking a little bit about my experience being trapped in a car during a wildfire. And I went online and I did some research and actually found a WikiHow article called How to Survive Being Trapped in a Vehicle During a Wildfire. And I was kind of shaken because I thought, wow, this is an experience that other people have actually faced as well. But doing a little bit more research in the ninth grade and actually looking into how climate change makes wildfires a lot worse and harder to put out, after hearing events on the news about how wildfires had destroyed homes, I could connect this to myself. And that's what inspired me to go out and actually do some volunteering for environmentalism. I actually now also sit on the city's Environmental Action Committee, where I can look at policies and how they drive our city to be more sustainable. But when we look at any influential leader, any entrepreneur, any movie or campaign, they're always driven by a motive or a story. So if we can tap into that, what motivates us to engage with certain social issues or to care about something, we can influence other people to do the same. So the next time, instead of just using statistics or something fancy in order to get people to care, we can use our own personal experiences, or maybe it's an experience of a friend or a family member. I guess what I'm trying to say is that stories can catch on and spread kind of like wildfire in a very influential way. And that's why they're important for our next generation to be able to influence change, to be able to inspire people to care, to connect, to motivate, and to be honest, and also to self-realize. So let's tell our stories, our good ones, bad ones, funny ones, and everyone that makes us feel something in a certain way. Because I feel like they're the most powerful tools that we can use in any form of communication. So let's change the world one invented language or story at a time. Thank you.